We live in exceptional times. There have never been more scientists on this planet than today, and they're making scientific breakthroughs at an exponential rate. So every year, the world spends $2.3 trillion to fund 8 million scientists. And we do all of this so we can live longer, healthier, and more prosperous lives. Every year, these scientists write 2 million scientific articles where they report their results. Now, this sounds all great, doesn't it? But there is a problem here that few are aware of, but that deeply affects all of us. And the problem is that 90% of these scientific results are locked up behind expensive paywalls. Cures to diseases, clean energy solutions are just not widely accessible. You, the taxpayers, have paid for this research, yet you cannot access it. The doctor who is treating you today does not have access to the latest medical studies. And worse, even many scientists can't read these articles because many universities actually can't afford to pay all the subscription fees to all the scientific journals out there. Imagine, from your taxpayers' money, you pay for the highways in your country. And then imagine a company would come along and put up a toll gate and charge you so much money that only the richest cars can afford to use this highway. Now, we would never allow this to happen on our roads, would we? But then why? Why are we allowing this to happen to our scientific knowledge? The gatekeeper, the subscription journal system, justifies itself by saying that they're allowing only the highest impact studies, the best research, to pass through. But as well, studies have shown that trying to predict impact is like gambling. And a serious side effect of the selection process is that many valid studies get at first rejected and are bounced around from journal to journal until they finally do get published. It happens even to the best research. Take, for example, this article on graphene. It was rejected twice and took at least 1 year to get published. And then, in 2010, this article went on to win the Nobel Prize in Physics. The scale of the problem is actually massive. Of the 2 million science articles that are published every year, at least 1 million valid research articles are at first rejected and bounced. Just one bounce delays the publication by at least 6 months. And that means that the total delay introduced to publish valid research is at least 500,000 years, every single year. It also means that researchers waste at least 100 million hours in resubmitting their research article to another journal at a cost of $10 billion every year. Just imagine if researchers would use this amount of time and money to find a solution for cancer, Alzheimer's disease, or climate change. Now, the good news is that there is an extremely simple solution out there today, and it's called open science. And in open science, everybody in the world has the right to access the latest research articles and the data for free. In a closed subscription model, universities pay publishers so that their scientists can read the articles. In the new open science model, universities also pay publishers, but this time to process all their valid research articles, and then everybody can read for free. And ironically, it costs much less to process articles, so universities could actually save $6 billion every year to do more research. The closed subscription system hunts for these few best articles and introduces these massive delays. The new open science model takes on the responsibility to publish all valid research articles and instead focuses on optimizing efficiency and quality control. And if we were to adopt open science universally, we could completely eliminate those 500,000 years of delay. Now, as a neuroscientist, I saw these problems firsthand. And together with my husband, Henry, who is also a neuroscientist, we decided to do something about this. So 9 years ago, we started Frontiers, which is an open science platform and today one of the largest open access publishers in the world. And because we commit ourselves to publish all the valid science out there, the biggest challenge that we actually face is the following. How do you process large amounts of articles efficiently and at the highest quality possible? Well, publishing is not the only industry that faces this type of quality at scale challenge. Take, for example, air traffic control. Here, the worst case scenario is a plane crash, very obviously. For us, that would translate into publishing a bad article. The second worst case scenario is grounded planes. For us, that would mean that articles would get delayed in the pipeline. So then how do you fly many planes safely? Well, the first thing that you need to fly safely is the very best pilots. So Frontiers has only leading researchers running the journals, currently 70,000 scientists from all the top universities, Harvard, Cambridge, Oxford, Stanford, and so forth. And their role is to peer review and quality control the articles. Their role is not to select for impact. For that, we've actually built online technology that measures the readership and the impact of the articles objectively online. And because we do not try to predict impact, which is highly debatable, we can also be completely transparent. So we publish the names of the people who judge the articles, and we link them to online profiles so that everybody in the world can see who reviewed, edited, and authored the articles. And that type of transparency has never been done before in publishing, and it introduces a chain of accountability. Now, the next thing that you need to fly safely is standard operating procedures at each stage of the flight and the very best technology to enable your pilots. So Frontiers has built an online review forum where reviewers and authors can interact with each other. And we've automated all the quality checks, and we built an online cockpit so that editors are actually alerted to tasks and quality checks that require their attention. While in the background, thousands of workflows guide the articles through the pipeline. Now, does this model work? Yes, it does. Very occasionally, a bad paper may slip through because no system or human is foolproof, but we actually use these occasions to improve our operating procedures and the quality checks. Overall, open science works extremely well. And I'm going to illustrate this on two examples, Frontiers and the Public Library of Science, also called PLOS, which is one of the very first open science pioneers. So the success of open science can be measured through quality and impact. And we're going to start looking at quality first. So here what you can do is you can compare the citation rates of journals to each other. And when you do that, you'll find that open access journals are amongst the top most cited journals in the world. Take, for example, PLOS One. Now, this is a multidisciplinary open access journal which was started at the National Institutes of Health about 10 years ago. And within record time, this became the largest journal in the world. And PLOS One articles receive as many citations as three of the world's oldest and most famous science journals combined. Let's look at Frontiers. Frontiers publishes the two most cited psychology journals in the world, the most cited neuroscience publishing program, and the second most cited physiology journal in the world. Now, quality obviously works. Let's look at readership impact. The 60,000 articles published so far received more than 250 million views from all over the world, massively in Europe, in the US, India, Latin America. And most strikingly, some of the most reading areas are economic hubs. Because we are today in the fourth industrial revolution. And most companies today, whether they're small or big alike, they all depend on technological and scientific innovation to survive and to thrive. And today's economy is a knowledge economy. And in this context, having efficient and open access to the latest science is important, not just for the innovation cycle, but as well for economic growth. And the best example to illustrate this is actually the Human Genome Project. Now here, at first, there was, well, serious attempts to patent genes and as well lock them away behind expensive subscription paywalls. But luckily for all of us, it was decided to make the human genome an open resource. And the impact of that has been enormous. The open gene databases have been used by geneticists to design the first gene editing therapies for cancer. And for every dollar invested, $145 were made in return. The Human Genome Project catalyzed the entire biotech industry, which today is an industry worth hundreds of billions of dollars every single year. So then, why do we need open science so urgently right now? Well, what makes me get out of bed every morning and build an open science platform like Frontiers is actually very simple. I want my children to live on a healthy planet. A planet where bees and frogs are not just things that you see in the Natural History Museum. And we are out of time to debate climate change. We gotta be implementing those solutions right now. And for that, we need access to our latest science results. Over the past 10 years, a range of remarkable pioneers, research institutions, funders, policymakers, they all brought to life open science. But the reality is that still today, 90% of our latest science results remain locked up. And if they remain locked up and delayed, those solutions may just not come in time. So just imagine if we had full access to our latest science, how that would accelerate innovation, economic growth, and all the solutions that we need for a sustainable future. There've never been more scientists on this planet than today. They've never had more resources. They've never made more discoveries. We are today in a better position to solve any type of problem than ever before in human history. And science can bring us clean energy, sustainable cities, and healthy food. And we can make more money in the process. So yes, we can have it all. So let's just do it now. Let's make our science open. Thank you.